Hi, I'm Jason, and welcome to DS University. Thank you for choosing the Etatron e128 Medicator for the solution to your medicating and water treatment needs. Today, we are troubleshooting the e128 Medicator. The key areas in troubleshooting are, 1, all the e128 LEDs are off and the pump is not stroking. 2, the e128 has LEDs lit, but there's no function from the controls. 3, the E128 is stroking but not drawing chemistry. 4, the E128 draws chemistry but does not inject. 5, alarm LED on the E128 is green. 6, alarm LED on the E128 is red. 7, the E128 does not run in either program, 1 pulse per 1 gallon or 1 pulse per 10 gallons. In this video, we include key areas 5, 6, and 7. To see other troubleshooting videos, check out dilutionsolutions.com. It's best to perform troubleshooting in a clean area, but if your Etatron is installed, cover your chemical bucket so you don't lose any parts. For this video, you will need a 3mm Allen wrench, diagonal pliers or cutters, voltage tester, small towel, flat blade screwdriver, and if you don't have a syringe, you will need the syringe kit. Part 5. If the alarm LED is green, this means the suction or underload alarm is triggered. The E128 senses there is a problem with the suction and strokes about 10 times. The LED turns green and then the pump stops. If the alarm LED on the E128 is green, you need to 5A, replace or refill your chemical bucket or stock tank. 5B, inspect the suction valve, foot filter, and the PVC suction tube's connections and condition. 5C, tighten the pump head. If any of the following sections from Part 5 allow the green LED alarm on the E128 to turn off, you no longer need to keep watching Part 5 of this video. Part 5A. If the alarm LED on the E128 is green and the chemical bucket or stock tank is empty, replace or refill your chemical bucket or stock tank now. Once the chemical bucket or stock tank is replaced or refilled, go through the priming process from the initial installation again. Part 5B. If the alarm LED on the E128 is green and the chemical bucket or stock tank is not empty, inspect the 1. Suction valve, 2. Foot filter, 3. PVC suction tube's connections and condition. Suction valve. Next, locate the suction valve at the bottom of the pump head. Loosen the suction valve tube nut and disconnect the PVC suction tube nut, collar, and nozzle attached. Check to see if the black transit washer is stuck to the nozzle and removed. If not, see if it is at the bottom of the suction valve. You may need to use a flat blade screwdriver to remove. Make sure not to lose the O-ring directly above the transit washer. With the PVC suction tube disconnected, please inspect the tubing connections. Remove the nozzle and collar from the tube and set aside. Do not lose them. Look at the end of the tube. If the tube's end is flared, use diagonal pliers or cutters to cut the flared portion off. Slide the collar onto the tube and make sure the collar's crown is pointing away from the tube nut. Take the nozzle and insert the pointed end into the opening of the same tube. Push the collar and nozzle together as close as possible. Pull the tube nut toward the nozzle to compress the collar and nozzle tight together, forming a ferrule connection. Reattach the tube and tube connections onto the suction valve by hand tightening the tube nut. Do not cross-thread nor over-tighten. If the tube nut is not securing, recheck the ferrule connection. Pull the tube nut toward the nozzle once more to compress the collar and nozzle together. Retighten the tube nut until secure. Foot filter. Inspect the foot filter by taking it out of the chemical bucket or stock tank. Loosen the foot filter tube nut and disconnect the PVC suction tubing, tube nut, collar, and nozzle attached. Let the tubing hang from the pump head while you inspect the foot filter. Shake it back and forth. You should hear a ceramic ball moving freely inside. If not, separate the foot filter into 3 pieces by popping the filter basket from the filter body. The filter seat may stick to the filter body. Make sure it rests in the filter basket instead to avoid losing the ceramic ball. Set the filter body aside and locate the ceramic ball in the filter seat. If there is no ceramic ball, switch out the current foot filter with a new one or call Dilution Solutions at 1-800-451-6628 for assistance. Pull the filter seat out of the filter basket and set the filter basket aside. Pour the ceramic ball out of the filter seat and into your hand. Set the filter seat down and use a small towel to wipe the ceramic ball clean. Do not misplace it. While holding onto the ceramic ball, inspect the 2 blue O-rings in the grooves of the filter seat and make sure they are not damaged. Put the ceramic ball back into the filter seat and set the filter seat aside. Grab the filter body and inspect to make sure the small blue O-ring on the top of the filter body is not damaged. If any O-ring is damaged, switch out the current foot filter with a new one or call Dilution Solutions at 1-800-451-6628 for assistance. Set the filter body down. Grab the filter basket and put the filter seat back into the filter basket. Insert the filter basket into the filter body and forcefully pop them together. This may take a couple of tries. Pull on the two sections to make sure they are connected securely. Shake the foot filter back and forth once more, verifying the ceramic ball is moving freely. Set the foot filter aside. Tube condition. Grab the PVC suction tubing hanging down from the suction valve. Remove the nozzle and collar from the tube and set aside. Do not lose them. Look at the end of the tube. If the tube's end is flared, use diagonal pliers or cutters to cut the flared portion off. Reattach the tube connections onto the loose end of the PVC suction tubing and be mindful of the orientation for the tubing connections. Push the collar and nozzle together as close as possible. Pull the tube nut toward the nozzle to compress the collar and nozzle tight together, forming a ferrule connection. Grab the foot filter and reattach the tube and tube connections onto the foot filter by hand tightening the tube nut. Do not cross thread nor over tighten. If the tube nut is not securing, recheck the ferrule connection. Pull the tube nut toward the nozzle once more to compress the collar and nozzle together. Retighten the tube nut until secure. Always be mindful of the orientation for the tubing connections. This is key because without the proper orientation, it can allow air into the system, causing the E128 to not operate correctly. To finish up, look at the PVC suction tube's condition. If the tube's cracked, rigid, or looks really old, just replace it now. Lastly, place the foot filter back into the chemical bucket or stock tank, making sure it is sitting vertically. Part 5C, if the alarm LED on the E128 is green, tighten the pump head. Over time, the pump head may work itself loose from the pump. To check this, remove the four white caps on the pump head. This can be done with your finger or a flat blade screwdriver. Set the white caps aside and do not lose them. Underneath the white caps are four screws. Using the Allen wrench, tighten the four screws about an eighth of a turn each. Reinsert the four white caps back over the screws. The green E128 suction or underload alarm should now turn off. Part 6. If the alarm LED is red, this means the discharge or overload alarm is triggered. The E128 senses there is a problem with the discharge and strokes about 10 times. The LED turns red and the pump stops. This cause is typically from when the pressure in the supply line exceeds the capacity of the E128, in this case, 101 psi. If the alarm LED on the E128 is red, you need to 6A, assess the pressure of the installation. 6B, inspect the injection and discharge valves, tubing connections, and the tube's condition. If any of the following sections from Part 6 allow the red LED alarm on the E128 to turn off, you no longer need to keep watching Part 6 of this video. Part 6A, if the alarm LED on the E128 is red, assess the pressure of the installation. Assess if the pressure of the installation is too high by using a pressure gauge. Part 6B, if the alarm LED on the E128 is red, inspect the 1. Discharge valve, 2. Injection valve, 3. Rigid discharge polyethylene tube condition. Discharge valve. Start with the discharge valve at the top of the pump head. Loosen the discharge valve tube nut and lift the discharge tube. Tube nut, collar, and nozzle attached. Check to see if the black transit washer is stuck to the nozzle and removed. If not, see if it is at the top of the discharge valve. You may need to use a flat blade screwdriver to remove. If it's in either place, proceed to the next step. Make sure not to lose the O-ring directly underneath the transit washer. With the rigid discharge tube disconnected, please inspect the tubing connections. Remove the nozzle and collar from the tube and set aside. Do not lose them. Look at the end of the tube. If the tube's end is flared, use the diagonal pliers to cut the flared portion off. Reattach the tube connections onto the loose end of the connected discharge tubing and be mindful of the orientation for the tubing connections. Push the collar and nozzle together as close as possible. Pull the tube nut toward the nozzle to compress the collar and nozzle tight together, forming a ferrule connection. Reattach the tube and tube connections onto the discharge valve by hand tightening the tube nut. Do not cross thread nor over tighten. If the tube nut is not securing, recheck the ferrule connection. Pull the tube nut toward the nozzle once more to compress the collar and nozzle together. Retighten the tube nut until secure. Injection valve. Next, locate the injection valve in the supply line. Loosen the injection valve and disconnect the discharge tube, tube nut, collar, and nozzle attached. Remove the nozzle and collar from the tube and set aside. Do not lose them. Look at the end of the tube. If the tube's end is flared, use diagonal pliers to cut the flared portion off. Reattach the tube connections onto the loose end of the connected discharge tubing and be mindful of the orientation for the tubing connections. Pull the tube nut toward the nozzle to compress the collar and nozzle tight together, forming a ferrule connection. Reattach the tube and tube connections onto the injection valve by hand tightening the tube nut. Do not cross thread nor over tighten. If the tube nut is not securing, recheck the ferrule connection. Pull the tube nut toward the nozzle once more to compress the collar and nozzle together. Retighten the tube nut until secure. Tube condition. Always be mindful of the orientation for the tubing connections. This is key because without the proper orientation, it can allow air into the system, causing the E128 to not operate correctly. To finish up, look at the rigid discharge tube's condition. If the tube's cracked, rigid, or looks really old, just replace it now. Please note, if the overload alarm LED is still red, it may be disabled. To check this, try to run the pump in standby mode. If it does run, the alarm is disabled. Please call Dilution Solutions at 1-800-451-6628 for assistance. The red E128 overload alarm should now turn off. Part 7. If the E128 does not run in either program, 1 pulse per 1 gallon or 1 pulse per 10 gallons, check the water meter interface and inspect the connection to the E128. Not all water meters are created equal. Sometimes they send too many signals or send signals too rapidly. In both cases, the E128 strokes too many times and sounds like a machine gun. First, check the water meter interface to see if the dial matches your desired program. Confirm the same program is set on the E128. If not, change the E128 program or replace the water meter so that the programs match. If the issue continues, inspect the connection to the water meter to see if it is loose or disconnected. The water meter makes the pump run, and if a connection is loose or disconnected by mistake between the pump and water meter, the E128 will not operate. If the connection is fine, disconnect the water meter and E128 lead wires from each other. Now, test the E128 individually. To do this, touch the lead wires of the E128 together. This simulates a signal from a water meter, closes the contact, and tells the pump to stroke. Do this in both 1 pulse per 1 gallon and 1 pulse per 10 gallon programs. Switch programs by putting the pump in standby mode and push the F or function button. If the E128 works individually, it's time to test the water meter. Do this by running fresh water through the supply line and look to see if the dial moves. If so, reconnect the E128 lead wires back into the water meter lead wires. Polarity typically does not matter, but if it does, the E128 white wire is positive. To finish up, run the E128 Medicator through both programs or at least through your desired setting to make sure it is working correctly. The E128 Medicator should now run correctly through the 1 pulse per 1 gallon or 1 pulse per 10 gallon programs. We hope this video has been helpful with troubleshooting key areas 5, 6, and 7 of your E128 Medicator pump. For more information, please call us at 1-800-451-6628 or visit us online at dilutionsolutions.com. I'm Jason at DS University. Thanks for watching.